just in this little to medium sized church. I've seen God take a dollar and turn it into 10 somehow. I've seen God take a hopeless person and give them hope. I've seen God take a person who didn't feel loved and just wrap them in it. And I've seen all of that in this building. And because I noticed it in this building, I started noticing it everywhere. And it's funny because there's dozens and dozens of places in the Bible where it talks about reap what you sow. And this church has been reaping love and kindness and hope day in and day out with a 100% volunteer staff for almost 2 years. And I am seeing the fruits of those seeds more and more every week. Every time we have a new person come in, we dope over them like crazy. We try not to embarrass them, but we can't help it. It's the joy that we feel in here that somebody new is here, and we hope that they'll stay and that they'll see the same things that I see and that they'll appreciate it and then take it out with them into the community to grow God's kingdom. Because we really reap what we sow.
Amen.
You know, when it comes to giving, you can give of your time, you can give of your money. I've been cleaning this church every week for months with the hope that eventually somebody will come clean my house. Hasn't worked yet, but I still have faith. So as we accept the tithes and offerings today, if you guys would just bow your heads for a quick prayer. Dear Father, thank you for another beautiful day. Thank you for the Odyssey Church. Thank you for bringing me to the Odyssey Church. It's through this church that I've been able to see you more clearly every day. And it is my prayer this morning that everybody in this room has that same experience. Not just while they're here, but when they're out and about. We ask that you continue to bless us here and everyone in the room, that you continue to guide us on how to cultivate the seeds that you plant so that we continue to do your good work. In your son's name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. This is not the small print of the gospel. This is not some hidden message in scripture. Jesus made it very clear that a decision to follow was a decision to die, to surrender everything to him. And so Jesus turns to the crowd, and he turns to you and me, and he asks the one question that will ultimately define our lives. Are you a fan or a follower?
Well, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
And I just want to thank everybody and welcome you to the Odyssey Church. And for those of you who may not know me, my name is Rob Welsh, and I have the very great privilege of being a pastor here, which just means I got here first and grabbed the microphone first, really, is all that means. But I do want to welcome you. You know, the fact that you take your time out of our hectic schedules today, we live in this 24-hour, 7-day-a-week world, and that you come here just means an awful lot. Let us sing with you and worship our Lord and just get to know you and fellowship together. And it's such an honor and privilege to be able to bring you the message that God has laid on my heart. And I do want you to know that I take that very seriously. I go to the Lord in prayer, and I know with great privilege comes great responsibility. So We're a church that believes in the full counsel of God. Sometimes you get the feel-good message, sometimes you get the ones that are a little tough. And you were here last week, and you know we started a new series called Not a Fan. And if you come to our discussion group Wednesday night, or if you come last week, then you know that this is a fairly challenging series. because we ask this question: are you just a fan? Are you someone who's in the stands enthusiastically waving Jesus on, or are you on the field playing the game and truly following Jesus? So it can be very challenging. Now, if you didn't hear the message last week, or you missed last week, or you'd like to hear it again, you can simply go to our YouTube channel. We have this real fancy name on YouTube. It's called The Odyssey Church. Make it real easy. And then we have our website, www.theodysseychurch.com. And you can watch it there as long as you have the internet or a computer or an iPad or a tablet or a phone or any of those things. And it'll be there hopefully for as long as there's internet and electricity in this world. So I just pray that as we get into this series, that we really take the time to reevaluate our relationship with God the Son, Jesus Christ, so that it will lead you into a deeper relationship with God the Father. In fact, that's what our mission and vision is here at the Odyssey Church, to help people find and follow Jesus so that we can lead people into a deeper relationship with Jesus Christ. And of course, we know it's not anything we do, that it's all through the power of the Holy Spirit, but we just praise God for everything that's going on. And if you're new here, we really do appreciate it. We've seen new faces almost every week, and some come and go, and we know this church is not for everybody, but we do feel that this is a church where you can truly find the love of Jesus Christ. And if we're doing something right, we'd like to know it, but if there's something that you feel that we're doing wrong, we'd like to know that too, because the only way we can change that is if you let us know. So there's some green connection cards in the back of the chairs. If you're new and you would mind filling those out, I'd really appreciate it. That way we can let you know a little bit more about us, and we get to know a little bit more about you, and that's really what we do here. We try to develop relationships because relationship is what Jesus was all about. And there's some prayer requests on the back. For those of you that believe in the power of prayer like I do, those prayer requests are taken seriously as well. We have a prayer box out front. We pray over it. We have a group meeting on Tuesdays if anybody wants to meet us, 8:30 to 9:30. And we pray collectively and corporately, and we pray over the requests that are given to us each week and the requests that people give us. And hopefully next week there will actually be some prayer cards out there too. My neglect, my fault, we just put it up and I forgot to put them in there. So last week, like I said, we started discussing what it means to be a fan of Jesus versus being a follower of Jesus Christ. And we've been talking about this Christian thing, about are we more than just a Christian? You know, we're going to find out later in this series that Christian is only really used in the Bible 3 times, and it's used in a sort of derogatory sense. Jesus never called his followers Christians. He called them disciples. So are we just a fan of Jesus Christ, or are we truly following Jesus Christ? In other words, we're beginning to learn what Jesus, in his own words, say he requires of us if we decide to follow him. And I really like the way that Kyle Ottman put it, who is the one who masterminded this series. We group it together, we pray about it, we put it into our own words, but it comes out of a book that was written by him and a discussion group that was written by him. And on Wednesday night, he said, have you made a decision to believe in Jesus Christ, or have you made a decision to follow Jesus Christ? Because, see, it's real easy to be a believer, but a follower means something entirely different. It means we have to make Jesus Christ Lord over every area of our lives. It means to be a follower of Jesus Christ, we have to do what Jesus says, not just say we believe in him and then do whatever we want to do. And if you believe as I believe, and this is important, if you believe as I believe that there really is a heaven and there really is a hell, then this really may be the most important question you ever ask yourself. What does it really mean to follow Jesus? What does Jesus say? What does Jesus require of us if we're to follow him? Now, we keep the cross up here to remind us of the first verse we talked about last week, which is the verses in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 9, verses 23 through 25. And like I said, we discussed that last week, but these are Jesus' words. They're also found in the Gospel of Matthew. They're also found in the Gospel of Mark. Anyone who would come after me must deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. Now again, like we mentioned last week, remember when Jesus said these words, he had not gone to the cross yet. We have sort of simplified what a cross means. But in Jesus' time, it was an extreme measure of execution. And Jesus is telling this crowd who must have looked at him like he was crazy, you have to pick up your cross every day. Pick it up daily and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for me will save it. For what good is it a man to gain the entire world and yet lose or forfeit his own life? If you really take this message, this series of messages, seriously as I think that you should, then it ought to hit you right between the eyes. I mean, it really should make you start thinking, wow, am I in a relationship with Jesus Christ, the living God, the one who raised from the dead? Or am I just a fan who's cheering him on, maybe enthusiastically, but really that's all I'm doing. Ask yourself, am I a follower of Jesus Christ? Am I willing to deny myself? Am I willing to do what Jesus tells me to do? Am I willing to pick that cross up every single day, even if it requires a sacrifice for myself? If it means denying what I want to do so I can do what Jesus wants to do? Because some of you who may not have been here last week, or maybe you were here last week, I just thought it would be a good idea sort of to give a couple of the highlights from last week so you can catch up, and for those of us who are here, to sort of refresh your memory. The overriding theme of this series is we have to define our relationship with Jesus Christ. You know, sooner or later in every relationship, there's a time that we have to define what's going on. The define the relationship talk, the DTR talk. Are we going forward in our relationship or are we going backward in our relationship? Is it a casual relationship or are we truly committed? Are we playing lip service or are we all in? Is Jesus the one and only or is Jesus one of many? And this is really a tough talk when you think about it. I mean, most of us don't like to have that DTR, the define the relationship talk, with anybody. You know, even in our relationships, it's not a one-time thing. You continually define your relationship. Me and my wife have been married for almost 20 years, and we're continually talking to each other. What does it mean? What are we going? What direction are we going into? And we have to do the same thing with Jesus Christ. And if you're like me, it sort of makes you feel uncomfortable, especially when I'm talking to Jesus, because I know there's areas in my life that I haven't truly fully surrendered. There's some areas in my life where I know that I'm not all in, and I'm sure most of you probably feel the same way. So a lot of times what we do is we just sort of avoid this question. We just do go through the motions. We just come to church, and somebody asks if you're a Christian, you say yes, but, you know, it sit down and really think about it requires a little bit from us. You know, and for some of us, it may be because we just simply fear commitment. You know, there was a time in my life where I didn't want to be committed to anything. Sometimes it's because we fear, well, you know, I know I can't do it. I got these problems in my life, and I just know that I can't follow Jesus the way he requires. And you know what? You'd be absolutely correct. You can't do it on your own. But God has promised us. Jesus promised. He has sent a comforter. He has sent someone to give us strength. He has sent his Holy Spirit to help us do what we can't do on our own. And for some of us, it simply takes us out of our comfort zone. You know, when I first really surrendered my life to Christ and my friends started coming to me, it cost me something. You know, I was right when I thought, well, it's going to cost me some friends. Well, it did. And that took me out of my comfort zone. For some people, you know, you have this big problem, you know, because we have to acknowledge that it's not all about us. It's not about our preferences. It's not the way we'd like it to be sometimes. It's not all about us. We have to change some things sometimes in our lives, and most people don't like change. And for some of us, it's simply because we don't want to stop doing what we're doing. We don't want to start doing some of the things that we know we should be doing. I have a person in my life that I'm very close to. He's a family member. I love him every bit with my heart. I'd probably die for him if he asked me to, or if he needed to. But he tells me, I know Jesus Christ is the real thing. I know that Jesus Christ died for my sins. But he says, I'm honest with you. I like the lifestyle I'm in. I like to do the things that I do. And I'm just too selfish to quit doing them. I'm too selfish. I like what I do. And I don't want to start doing the things that Jesus tells me I have to do. Now, I'm not his final judge, but according to the Bible, if he died today, he'd probably split hell wide open. And the thing is, he knows it. I mean, he's a great fan of Jesus. If you ask him if he's a Christian, he'll tell you he's a Christian. If he asks you to believe Jesus died for sins, he'll tell you that. But he says, I'm not going to live for him because he's not willing to deny himself and sacrifice to follow Jesus. He's made a decision to believe in Jesus, but he didn't make the decision to follow Jesus. And the scriptures confirm that it's just not enough to make a decision to simply believe in Jesus. You have to deny yourself. You have to pick up your cross every day and follow Jesus. And sometimes, and most of the time, that is going to require some kind of personal sacrifice. The half-brother of Jesus, who is a man by the name of James. And we say half-brother. Sometimes that sort of confuses people. But we believe that God, the Holy Spirit, was the father of Jesus. And James had an earthly father. Both had the same mother. But he writes in his letter to believers, and really, this letter's been miraculously preserved for almost 2,000 years, and it's recorded near the end of our Bible. We call it the Book of James, but it really was a letter, and it was written to the Christians of the time who were under a lot of persecution. And in the second chapter of this book of James, in the chapter verse 19, Jesus, the James, his brother, writes, "You say you have faith? For you believe that there is one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Well, great for you, good for you. Even the demons believe this, and they tremble in terror." You made a decision to believe in Jesus Christ? Well, that's great. Good for you. That puts you in the same category as the demons in hell. You should tremble in fear. Because believing Jesus is not enough. You have to make a decision to deny yourself, pick up your cross every day, and follow him. And then, and only then, can you have the assurance of salvation. And I know this is a tough message. I know that. But these are not my words. These are the words of Jesus Christ himself. So think about this. You know, you're walking along one day, and Jesus walks up to you and says, "Hey, let's go out for coffee. Let's sit down. Let's define our relationship." What would you tell him? What would your lifestyle tell him? I mean, are you willing to follow his commands even if it meant things in your life had to change? And if you really do this, you're going to see you just can't go through the motion. You have to sit down and talk to God. You have to see where this relationship is going. Jesus says in Matthew chapter 5, and he's actually quoting a verse from Isaiah, but he says, "These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far away from me." And then he gives us this stern warning. "They worship me in vain." It doesn't mean anything. It's a farce. Their teachings are rules, but taught by man. Fans say the right things. Followers do the right thing. Are you a fan or a follower? Is your worship in vain? Is your worship worth anything? So last week, to get this on track, what we did is we asked three questions to sort of define our relationship. We asked these questions, and they were challenging questions because you have to look deep within your heart, and if you answer them honestly, they are tough questions. The first question was simply, why are you here? I mean, you have to ask yourself, why are you here this morning? Are you here to praise or are you here to police? You know, a lot of people come to church just to make sure the pastor and the church is doing the things that they're supposed to be doing. Are you here to worship or are you here to watch? Are you here for yourself, or are you here for somebody else? Are you here for what Jesus can do for you, or are you here for who Jesus really is? And then the second question is, are you all in? Have you really given all your heart and all your mind and all your strength and all your soul to following Jesus Christ? That's a tough question. Are you willing to make it about Jesus and his will instead of about you and your will? Are you willing to pick up your cross every day and allow something or someone and maybe a lot of discomfort in your life and follow Jesus wherever he takes you and do whatever he tells you to do? And it's really easy to say yes. Now, I'm talking from experience. You know, I want you to know that. For 15 years, I felt like I was surrendered to Jesus. I felt like I was doing the all things. Right, I ran two businesses and owned two businesses that were with Christian symbols. I thought I was doing everything right. But I found out that I really was not all in. I was really trying to do it for me and not for Jesus. So, if that's where you're at, there's no condemnation in Jesus Christ. I'm not trying to do that at all. I'm just trying to get you to think, because I spent most of my Christian, you know, service as a fan, not a true follower. And we all like to think that we're all in, don't we? But you have to look deep within your heart and say, why do I come to church? You know, why am I coming to church? What is it that I come for? Am I really all I am? Am I willing to sacrifice and die to self so that I can live for Jesus Christ? And then you have to ask yourself, have you made it your own? And that is a tough question as well, because are you coming here because of your relationship with Jesus, or are you coming here because it makes somebody else happy? Are you coming here because you want to worship your Lord and Savior? It's just easier. Or are you a Christian by association only? See, Jesus doesn't want a relationship with you and somebody else. He says, this is personal. This is intimate. You have to make it your own. Jesus loves you. And his greatest desire is that we have this personal and this intimate relationship with him. See, that's what this series is all about. It's about becoming more than just a fan of Jesus. It's about becoming more than just an enthusiastic follower of Jesus. More than just being a Christian. It's about becoming a disciple of our Lord Jesus Christ. A true follower of Jesus. Now, our gospel text this morning is going to be found in the Gospel of Mark chapter 2. Verses 13 through 17. So if you have your Bibles, turn them to Mark chapter 2, and I'll be there in a few minutes, but the words will be up here on the screen so they're easy to follow as well. And the story that we're going to be talking about is the story of Jesus calling Levi. Most people know him as Matthew. But the story of Matthew the tax collector and him being called by Jesus to follow. See, Jesus does the same thing to Levi or Matthew that he did to Simon. And again, we call Simon Peter. We would commonly refer to him as Peter, and he had a brother named Andrew, and then there was James and John. And beginning in chapter, just sort of set the story up, in Mark chapter 1, beginning about verse 16, the gospel says, as Jesus walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon, and that's Peter, and his brother Andrew. So Peter and his brother Andrew are sitting in a boat, they're casting a net into the lake because they were fishermen. And Jesus says, come follow me. And Jesus said, I will make you fishers of men. The Bible says, at once they left their nets and followed him. When he went a little farther, he saw James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John in a boat, repairing their nets. And without delay, he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. So Jesus, he gives this open invitation. He gives this open invitation to these fishermen, and they leave everything they know to go follow Jesus. They leave their jobs, they leave their careers, they leave their friends, they leave their family. I mean, the two brothers of James and John, they even leave their father sitting in a boat with the hired help. They're employees, they're trying to prepare the nets, and they leave everything behind to follow Jesus. So we have to ask ourselves sometimes, is this invitation from Jesus to come and follow him, is this something that I really believe in? Is this a really an open invitation? Is this been given to me? And if it has, where do I stand with it? How can I define my relationship with Jesus? So after we've had this DDR chart, define the relationship with Jesus, what do we do next? What's the next step for us? Where do we go from here? And that's what the message is about this week. Does Jesus really invite anyone and everyone to follow him? When Jesus says anyone, does he really mean everyone? Now think about this. I'm sure you've heard. See those type of car commercials, or those life insurance commercials, or those health insurance commercials, or credit card commercials on TV, or in the Sussex Guide, or in the newspaper, in the Wave. And here's what they promise you: guaranteed approval. Guaranteed approval. Anybody can get a car. Anybody can get life insurance. Anybody can get health insurance. Anyone can get a credit card. I mean, it seems like a very, very open invitation to everybody and anyone and everyone who wants it. Guaranteed approval. You're approved. No conditions. Nothing. But do they really mean anyone? Somebody's already answered it. You're right. They mean everyone if they read the fine print. Seems like whenever people say anyone is welcome or anybody can cash in on this deal or everyone is approved, they don't really mean anyone, do they? There's always a catch. What do you think of when you hear the words anyone or anyone, everyone is eligible, anyone can get this? When you hear that ad, you feel like I get sometimes, you're very skeptical. You start reading the fine print. And then you find out, well, it's not really an open invitation. In fact, it's a pretty exclusive group that gets to do this. It really isn't for anyone. If you don't have a job, if you don't have money, if you don't have any way to pay your bills, if you don't have a driver's license, if you don't have any insurance, you ain't getting a loan approved for a car. I don't care what the ad says. If you're on your deathbed, you're probably not going to get life insurance or health insurance. When they say anybody can get a credit card, what they really mean is anybody can get a prepaid credit card. You put enough of your own money in their bank, you'll be able to use your own money through their credit card service, and they will charge you to use your own money. It sounds too good to be true, and we find out, you know what? It really is too good to be true. In reality, this is a limited open invitation, and that's just the way it is. So some people, they begin to feel the same way. We've been conditioned to feel the same way about Jesus' open invitation. It seems too good to be true. The open invitation to follow him, to have eternal life with this perfect peace, this open invitation to have all your sins forgiven, this open invitation to have an abundant and meaningful life right here, right now, right on this earth, in this life, just seems to be too good to be true. Does anyone really mean anyone? That's the question we're trying to explore this morning. Is anyone really welcome? We're going to watch a short video, and then I'll begin to read from the Gospel of Mark chapter 2, beginning in verse 13.
When Jesus said to Matthew, "Follow me," he was making it clear that his invitation to follow was not just for the religious elite or for the morally upright, for those who have their lives together. His invitation is for all of us who are hiding some stains. Jesus said, "Anyone who would come after me must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me." Anyone. Anyone is a pretty inclusive word. Anyone can follow Jesus. Anyone who's ever thought to themselves, "I've gone too far, my stain is too big." Anyone who's ever laid awake at night and said, "I can't believe what I've done." Anyone who's ever looked in the mirror and said to themselves, "I can't believe what I've become." Anyone can follow.
So that's the first point I want you to see this morning, is that when making the invitation to his potential followers, Jesus invites anyone and everyone. And when Jesus says anyone, he means anyone. Anyone and everyone is welcome to follow Jesus. In verse 13 and 14 in the Gospel of Mark chapter 2, Jesus says, "Once again, Jesus went out beside the lake. A large crowd came to him, and he began to teach them. As he walked along, he saw Levi." Now Levi, we know, is Matthew. "Levi, the son of Alphaeus, sitting at the tax collector group. Follow me," Jesus told him, and Levi got up and followed him. See, when Jesus says anyone, he meant anyone. We sort of read that la la la. Because if any of Jesus' followers felt that they couldn't follow Jesus, it was probably Matthew. Matthew had even tried to stop trying, or even trying to sound religious. In all likelihood, most of Matthew's childhood friends had already deserted him. They'd written him off. At the very least, he would have been a great disappointment to his mother and father. I mean, they had much different plans for Matthew than what Matthew was doing. I mean, to be given the name Levi meant that your parents expected you to serve the Lord as a Levite in the Old Testament. From birth, Matthew, Levi, was probably set aside to be a spiritual leader for the nation of Israel. By the age of 12, Matthew would have been required to memorize the first five books of the Bible, what the Jewish people call the Torah. Most of us find Leviticus so boring, we just sort of skip over it. But Matthew was required to memorize it before he was even a teenager. He also had to memorize Genesis, Deuteronomy, the book of Numbers, book of Exodus, all before the age of 13. And it's likely that Matthew probably had tried to become a disciple of one of the rabbis. Now, it's not like coming to church today. If he sent his application in, it was turned down. You had to seek permission to follow one of the rabbis. You just couldn't openly walk and follow just any rabbi. You had to to pass a very intensive application process. You had to go to the rabbi and say, may I follow you? And this just isn't a normal group of people. When somebody asked a rabbi, may I follow you? They were simply saying, teach me what you know. I want to be your student. They were saying, teach me what you knew. I want to follow you. But you had to sort of apply, and either the application would accept it or an application would be denied. And Matthew's probably was denied. They were saying, if you wanted to follow a particular rabbi, what they were saying is, I want to follow you everywhere you go so I can be just like you. So I can think like you. So I can walk like you. So I can live like you. I want to know what you know, live like you live, do what you do. They were required, when you went to follow a rabbi at this point in time, you were required to leave everything you know. You had to leave your job. You had to leave your relationships. You had to leave your family. You had to leave everything behind you to follow this rabbi. And you would go with the rabbi wherever he went. Whenever he was teaching, you'd be there. But you followed him everywhere he went so you could be just like him. If the rabbi went to visit a sick person, you went with him to visit the sick person. If the rabbi went to the store to buy food, you went and followed him to buy food. There'd be a line of his disciples by him because they wanted to do everything that the rabbi did. If the rabbi went to visit another rabbi, his disciples followed him. Whatever the rabbi did, wherever he went, the disciples followed him. They were like little ducklings following their mom. You'd go to a rabbi and you'd say, hey, I need to follow you. And he'd either accept you as a student or he'd reject you as a student. And very, very, very few people were ever accepted. And the ones who were accepted were the very best of the best. They were the cream of the crop. These disciples, they were actually called a Talmid. The group of disciples itself that followed his disciples were called a Talmid. T-A-L-M-I-D, Talmid. And to be a Talmid of a particular rabbi meant you had to go through this intensive application process. The rabbis knew the scriptures inside and out. They had this extensive knowledge of the first five chapters of the Bible, what's known as the Torah again. They knew the teachings, they knew the writings of the prophets, and they knew the law, and they were respected in their community. And every rabbi knew that his Talmid, his disciples, were a reflection upon him. So the brighter his students were, the more he was respected as a teacher. So the application process was very, very difficult. You couldn't be good, you had to be great. The rabbi might say something like this. I want you to quote from the book of Leviticus, from memory, chapter 15, go. And you'd have to quote chapter 15 of the book of Leviticus. Now, most of us have a hard time reading the book of Leviticus. I don't know anybody that can quote it from memory. But Matthew would have been required to do that. In all likelihood, Matthew had flunked out of rabbi school. He couldn't measure up. And whatever had happened, we know something had gone wrong in Matthew's life. Because instead of serving God, Matthew was now serving himself. He turned his back on his very own people. He turned his back on God, and he became a tax collector for the Romans. His job was to take money from his people and give it to the occupying enemy, the Romans. Matthew was regarded as the worst kind of sinner. He had his very own category of sinner. Jesus would say things like, there are sinners, and then there's tax collectors and prostitutes. They were the bottom of the rung. They were the worst of the worst. He was seen as a traitor not only to his nation, but to his religion, to his friends, to his family, to everybody he knew. And the Romans didn't like him. They just tolerated him because he collected taxes. And what Matthew would do is he'd collect the taxes the Roman required, and anything he got above that, he got to put in his own pocket. And there's no such thing as an honest tax collector at that time. But even if he could collect the taxes fairly, even if he did it honestly, he's still working for the enemy. As a tax collector, he cheated his own people to line his pockets. Tax collectors were seen such social outcasts and seen as such a sinner that they were considered to be what they called ceremonially unclean. They weren't even allowed in the outer courts of the tabernacle where the Gentiles could come in. His name had been scratched off the membership list. And sometimes I think, you know, maybe me and you have more in common with Matthew than we'd like to think we have. Now, I don't mean that we're stealing money from our neighbors or anything like that, but when we look back, at least for me, look back on my life, I can see that I was a disappointment in many different ways. I haven't always measured up. I haven't always made the cut. And the Apostle Paul writes in the book of Romans, you know, we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, which means basically none of us have made the cut.
That's right.
We've all said things that we shouldn't have said. We've all done things we wish we hadn't done. And as hard as we've tried to scrub out that stain, there's some things in my life that I wish I could go back and do and scrub that stain and sin out, but you just can't do it. It's not going to come out. So sometimes I picture Matthew, and he's sitting at his tax collector booth every day on this busy street, and he's thinking to himself, and he's thinking to himself, you know, as a little boy growing up, I just never imagined it would come to this. You know, what am I doing? In the moments where he was really honest to himself, you know, maybe late at night when he was staring up at the ceiling, he had to be full of guilt, full of regret, wish he could do things differently. You know, I've been there. But he's like, what can I do now? I already got this job, you know, I'm making the money that I'm used to this lifestyle. The stains are so set, they're never going to come out. He had to think, you know, I bet God doesn't even want anything to do with me anymore. You know, God, he can't love a person like me. I don't know about you. Maybe you felt that the one time. Maybe the things you've done, maybe the things you become, you think to yourself, God couldn't love me. God wouldn't want me. And I want you to know right now, that is a lie from the devil himself.
Yes.
Nothing can be apart from the truth. God sent his son to this earth to die for you. And if you were the only person that decided to follow him, he would have still died for you.
That's right.
And I tell you something, I found this true in my life. Maybe you found it yourself. The more you see how much God loves you, the more you see yourself as forgiven, you'll know that that open invitation that God offers is truly for everybody and anyone, and everybody includes you, and everybody includes me. See, Matthew knows the sin he's in. He's like this friend of mine. He knows that he's in sin. He's just not willing to do anything about it. Matthew's been told by the people around him, there's no hope for a person like you. Matthew's been told by the religious people, you can't have any hope. You better get everything you can get right now because you'll never be with God. You're a traitor. There's no hope. You know, maybe some of you have been in a church that sort of told you the same thing, or your friends have told you the same thing. It's just simply not true. You know, one day Matthew hears about this new rabbi who's come on the scene. And this teacher's different. He knows the scriptures backwards and forwards, and he's made them so easy to understand. He's taught with one with power and authority, as if he actually wrote the scriptures himself. And his followers, they're not the best of the best. They're not the cream of the crop. Some of them are the worst of the worst. I mean, they were fishermen. They were uneducated. They were lepers. They were outcasts. They were zealots. Zealots were the political hotheads of the day. Some of them were women. Women weren't even allowed to be rabbis. And a few of the women that Jesus let follow him, they were prostitutes. It was the common folk who were following Jesus. The lame, the blind, the adulterers. Everybody was allowed to follow Jesus. This unconventional rabbi. And then one day, Matthew's sitting in his tax collector's booth, and Jesus stops by. He didn't wait for Matthew to stop his sin. He stops right into his tax collector booth in the midst of his sins, and he begins to speak to Matthew, and nobody could have ever guessed what Jesus was about to say to him. It was simply two words. Follow me. A Jewish rabbi asking a tax collector to follow him? A tax collector for the Roman oppressors? Can you imagine what must have happened when word got out? There's this new rabbi in town, and he's encouraging, he's welcome everybody. Doesn't matter what you're doing to follow him. And all the people had to do was look at this rag-a-tag-bag of people that's following him, and they would know that when Jesus said anybody was welcome, Jesus meant anyone and everybody was welcome to follow him. So word gets out about this new rabbi who's picking followers at random. And people start to wonder what's going on. They come out to hear this incredible teacher, but when they look at his disciples, they had to be confused. This isn't what they're used to. This isn't the way it's always been. This isn't. They must have shook their heads and thought, and said, well, these aren't his students. They're nobodies. Those two guys over there, they're fishermen. few of them are these political people who are causing all the trouble. And then there's this guy, he's a local tax collector. What's going on here? What are these people? But then Jesus makes the invitation. And when people heard it, and when people heard that anybody could come and anybody could learn from this incredible rabbi, that they started to entertain the idea of actually following him. People who give up on their dreams of learning from a rabbi a long, long time ago were one now beginning to wonder. Slowly but surely people started to come and want to follow this rabbi by the name of Jesus. They realized when Jesus said anyone, he meant anyone and anybody could follow him. Now, if you sort of drifted off, if you've been counting the tiles or whatever you want to, I need you to come back, because this is important. This is the point that I want you to drive home. I've been there. Last church I was in, my kids told me exactly there were 1,370 ceiling tiles. All right, so understand. This gospel message of eternal life with Jesus Christ, the forgiveness of sins, and an abundant and meaningful life right now, right here, today, for anyone. And when Jesus says anyone, he means anyone. It's exactly what he means. It means anyone. Jesus says anyone can follow me, and it's an open invitation. But here's what's happening. I know you've seen it in churches, and I've seen it in churches, and I've seen it in people that call themselves Christians. But over the years, we've gotten to the point, even when we hear Jesus say anyone, we think, yeah, right. What's the catch? Well, here's the good news. There is no catch. There is no fine print. There is no hidden fees. Jesus said anyone, and he meant everyone. In our text this morning, it said Levi or Matthew got up and followed Jesus. And where does Jesus go? Matthew chapter 2, verse 15 and 16. While Jesus was having dinner at Levi's house. Levi's house? Levi is the worst sinner it is. Jesus went over there for dinner? He goes to the traitor's house? But he's not just there with Levi the sinner. Levi or Matthew goes on, and Mark goes on. He says, many tax collectors and many sinners were eating with him and his disciples, for there were many who followed him. Not everybody's happy with what's going on. And guess who the unhappiest people are? When the teachers of the law... It was the leaders of the church. When the teachers of the law, who were the Pharisees, saw him eating with sinners and tax collectors, they asked his disciples, why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners? I'm thinking, if I was a disciple, I'd say, why don't you go ask him yourself? He's sitting right over there. Jesus said anyone was welcome. The crowds began to understand that Jesus meant everyone was welcome. And it's true, everyone means anyone. But there's a struggle for most of us, because we probably never say it out loud. Some people do, but most people don't. We don't always buy into the idea that church should be for everybody. Amen. We sort of get used to church being a certain way, don't we? We usually prefer things to stay the same, and the same soon becomes the standard, and pretty soon the standard becomes a qualification. And Jesus comes along and he does away with all the boundaries. He does all away with all the barriers. He does all away with all the prerequisites, all the qualifications. Jesus said, I don't care what your test scores are. I don't care what you look like. I don't care what you dress like. I don't care how much you know about the Bible, and I don't care how you act. I don't care what your past has been. I don't care about the color of your skin. I don't care about your education, your financial status, your marital status. This is an open invitation, and it is open to everyone and anyone, and I mean everyone. And as a church, we need to follow the example of our rabbi, Jesus the Christ. I mean, are we imitating Jesus? Jesus let anybody follow him, but how are we, and I think we do a great job, but how are we about welcoming anybody into our church? What if? I mean, you think about it. What if in the town of Selbyville, the Odyssey Church got the reputation, became known as the church that's full of sinners? What if we became known as the church which welcomed everybody and anybody? Drunkard? Come on in. Adulterer? Come on in. Homosexual? Come on in. Prostitute? Come on in. Drug addict? Come on in. Thieves? Come on in. You name them, we welcome them.
All right.
And some people think, wait just a minute, let me get this straight. Let them clean up just a little bit, let them repent, and then we'll let them come to church and follow Jesus. But that is not what Jesus said. But you know that controversial 2,000 years ago, and it was controversial today. It caused conflict then, and it causes conflict now. I have a friend of mine that's a terrible alcoholic. I meet with him at least once a month, try to meet with him twice a month, just to talk and encourage him. And I got a friend that I thought was a friend that won't even respond to a text, an email, a Facebook message, or a phone call because I meet with an alcoholic. Now, come on. Shouldn't be meeting with sinners in hell. Cause conflict then, cause conflict now. Jesus said, let anyone follow, but we don't always buy the idea that the church is for everyone and anybody. We have these written expectations of people who attend church. We can have some unwritten expectations of the people who come through the doors of a church. I mean, don't we sometimes expect people to know how to behave when they come in there, behave a certain way, to know the rules and behave and do the things that we do, know when to stand, know when to sit, know at least a little bit about the Bible. But Jesus does away with all that. He takes the application process and throws it out the door. It's an open invitation. And I've witnessed this. I've seen this. Sometimes people come to church and they struggle to come to church. And they finally get there and then they struggle to stay in church because of these unwritten codes, these rules of man that the church makes as rules of God. And Jesus does away with all that. In fact, we need to listen carefully because Jesus warns us to be careful and not become like that. In the Gospel of Luke chapter 17, Jesus gives us this warning. Things that cause people to sin are bound to come. He said that's going to happen. There are going to be things in this world that are going to cause people to sin. It's just the way it is. We live in a fallen world. He said, but woe to that person through whom they come. It would be better for him to be thrown into the sea with a millstone tied around his neck than for him or her to cause one of these little ones to sin. And he says, so watch yourself. Whoa. Jesus warns us, if we try to keep people from coming to him or turn them away from him because of some kind of unwritten church rule or because of our traditions or trying to be in control to make sure who comes in and who stays out and they better do what we say they do, it would be better for them to be thrown into the sea with a millstone tied around their neck. A heavy rock. Jesus does away with all the qualifications to follow him. He got rid of the long list of prerequisites. He did away with the standard application process. And I think it's just about time the church did the same thing. Not this church, but the church with the big C. And I know change is stressful for everybody. I know that. I understand that. But Jesus comes along and he changes things. We have, and here's the thing, the Odyssey Church, as the leaders of the Odyssey Church, we have to be careful. We have to be intentional. We have to be purposeful. Or after a while, the way things are becomes the way that things always are. The way that we do things or the way that we should do things. And that becomes a standard. We start saying anybody is welcome, but subliminally we're saying everybody is welcome as long as they meet the application process. Yeah. And that is absolutely no argument, completely unscriptural. Jesus says, anyone, and by anyone, he means everybody and anyone. And that is why we started the Odyssey Church. I've been in, and I've served in some churches where they said everyone is welcome, but if you didn't meet their standards, if you didn't look like what they felt you should look like, if you didn't dress the way they thought you should dress, if you didn't say the things you ought to say, that you felt so judged, so condemned, that you just left and never came back. And Jesus says, everybody is welcome. Anyone has come to follow me. And we sometimes think if we just let anybody in, it'll make us feel uncomfortable. And let me tell you, it will.
Yes, it will.
So what happens is we say, not anyone, only those that look like us, talk like us, behave in a certain way, only if they listen to a certain kind of music. We had one person leave here because we played contemporary music on a keyboard instead of a piano. Sounds like a keyboard. It doesn't look like a piano, but it looks, plays like a piano. It's not a piano. They left. Oh, that's ridiculous. And Jesus clearly tells us that sometimes change is required. I mean, the very mission of the Odyssey Church is to reach the unchurched. Thing is, we're not called by God, but we're commanded to God to reach the unchurched. But we have to be careful because there's a gravitational pull that every single organization, and especially in churches, and the gravitational pull is to the insiders, not the outsiders. But not once in Scripture can I find where Jesus or God said, stay inside. Every time he said, go outside. He commands us to go out. And sometimes that requires change. And this is exactly what the religious people had against Jesus. This was a radical change from what they were used to. This was radical, the things that Jesus was talking about. And what Jesus had against them is that they weren't willing to change. And what was supposed to be a blessing for God's people had all of a sudden become a burden for God's people. The message is an open invitation to love God, not an open invitation to obey the rules. But sometimes we think, and like I said, all of us are guilty, including me, at times, anyone means only those that do it the way we do it, the way it's always been done. One person said that the worst, the scariest, the thing that hurts the church the most is the phrase, we've always done it that way. Mm-hmm. I've been in churches where they say, I don't care if the church is growing. I don't care that tithes and offerings grew up and people are learning maturity. I don't care that people are being challenged by the Word of God. I don't care if people are finding salvation and lives are being changed. If you don't do it the way we've always done it, then just simply don't do it. And people that think like that are simply not following the words of Christ. And they need to repent or they need to go somewhere else. Maybe they need to go to a church that did, and then they'll be happy. Because that's not what Scripture said, and that's not what I've been called to do. And I want to be a follower of Jesus Christ so bad. I'm tired of being a fan. And I believe that the heart of this church and the heart of the people that come here are the same way. And I hope that nobody feels, you know, like we have to do it a certain way, or we have to talk a certain way. But you know what? If you do, we'll be all right without you. I love you, but we will. Because it's not about you. It's about bringing the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ to a lost and dying world. And there's no qualifications. There's no standard to prerequisites. Amen. Jesus says anyone, and by anyone he means everyone. Jesus comes along and he removes these boundaries. He removes these barriers. He says anyone can come into the church and follow him, which means anyone and everyone is welcome into his church, and particularly here at the Odyssey Church. If you've got a friend in deep sin, bring them here. Let's teach them the Word of God.
Amen.
All right. Jesus didn't just say, get rid of the qualifications, though. Jesus did something else. Jesus said, anyone, and here's what it is. And this is the challenging part sometimes, because when he said anyone, when he said, I'm eliminating the qualifications, he also said something else. He said, I'm eliminating all your excuses. I'm getting rid of all your excuses. No qualifications means no excuses. Jesus said, you know, he just doesn't break down the barriers which keep so many people from learning more about God. He also gets rid of all the excuses that get people from coming to God. Mm-hmm. Different excuses people are hiding behind. When Jesus says anyone, he removes all these barriers and these boundaries, he takes our excuses away too. We can't say, well, I don't know enough about the Bible to go to church. We can't say, you know, I have too much sin in my life to go follow Jesus. I don't have the right kind of clothes to wear to church. We can't say, well, you know, I still drink. I still smoke a little pot. I still do some drugs. I still smoke cigarettes. We can't say that. We can't say, well, I'll get cleaned up and then I'll go to church. We can't say, well, I got to spend time with my family on Sundays, you know. I'll wait till the kids are all warm, then I'll follow. When Jesus says everybody is welcome, he removes the barriers, but he also removes the excuses as well. People you probably know are like this. What is the excuses that people use from wanting to this deeper relationship with Jesus Christ? More importantly, what is the relationship, you know, maybe what excuses that you've been using? Because I think all of us at times use some kind of excuse to hold off wanting into this deeper relationship with Jesus Christ that he requires and he wants us to have. You know? What is it? You know, is it, you know, I'm just too busy. I'm too many hours in the office. Sunday's the only day I got to sleep. Is it because, you know, and you know, maybe, you know, my marriage is not great, and I'm really focused on that lady, but, you know, the kids, you know, they're young, they need a lot of time, they need a lot of attention. See, this in today's world, we put more emphasis on their extracurricular activities than you do on their spiritual maturity. You know, kids got ball games on Sundays, we can't take them to church. It's because times have been tough, and you got to take a second job. Other people say it's because I've got this past. You know, I'm embarrassed to walk in there. I'm not proud of the things I've done. Guess what? So do I. You know, people come and they let the baggage of addiction and divorce and bankruptcy. And it's been an excuse for a long, long time. But Jesus says, hey, anybody can follow. Not only am I removing the boundaries, I'm removing the excuses too. Because it's easy to hide behind excuses. Because who's going to argue with somebody who's had a tragedy in life? Who's going to argue with somebody who's emotionally scarred? But Jesus says, listen, I'm getting rid of all that for you. I'm inviting anyone, and by anyone, I mean anyone. Anybody is welcome to have this relationship with Jesus. Anybody. You got a sexual past? Anyone. You got an ex-con? Anyone. You an inmate? Anyone. You recently divorced? Anyone. You legalistic? Anyone. Been bankrupt? Anyone. Pothead? Anyone. Alcoholic? Anyone. Adulterer? Anyone. Hypocrite? Anyone. Anyone means anyone. After Jesus asked Matthew, the tax collector, to find, they go to Matthew's house, and the religious people are all upset. He's hanging around the tax collector's hand. Jesus says in verse 17, on hearing this, Jesus said to them, it is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but the sinners. We're not careful. All of a sudden, we become this hotel for saints instead of a hospital for sinners. What is it that's been keeping you from following Jesus more closely? What is it that's keeping you a fan instead of being a follower? What excuses do you keep from being all in? Is it your past? Is it your baggage? What is it that's weighing you down? Is it your job, a divorce, family problems, a bankruptcy, your recreational habits? Have you been hurt in church before? Me too. Is it your pride? Is it what your friends may think? Is it family problems? See, we all sort of have this list that keeps us from following Jesus as closely as Jesus desires. It doesn't mean that we're not following. We're just not following as closely as he wants. And you know what? I would never argue with you about your reasons because I know they're valid. I know that. But anyone with any kind of history is welcome to come and follow Jesus. And as a church, we need to make them feel welcome because it's God's church, not our church.
Amen.
Jesus doesn't want a slice of your life. He wants all of life. He says, I want it all. You don't have to be all in to walk through the door of the church. Everybody is welcome. But sooner or later, Jesus does come to us, and he wants us to define the relationship we have with him. Are you a fan or are you a follower? We need to be ready for what can happen when we embrace that invitation for anyone. Because if anyone can come to the Odyssey Church, sometimes that'll sort of mess things up. All of a sudden, the church gets filled with a whole bunch of unchurched people. And if we really accept anyone into the Odyssey Church to follow Christ, we're going to have to be forced to deal with some of our unwritten codes. We'll be forced to get out of our comfort zones and rub shoulders with people from different backgrounds and different social circles. People who have different kinds of music collections. People who have different kinds of recreational activities than we do. People whose wardrobes might confuse us or even annoy us. People are hard to tolerate and even harder to love. But you know what? True followers of Jesus are willing to break down these walls, are willing to trash these unwritten codes and welcome anybody into God's family right alongside Jesus.
It is true.
Some of you may think, well, wait a minute. We just can't let anybody in the church. We just can't let anybody show up and invite them into God's family and tolerate anything they want to do. That's not biblical. Well, you know what? You're right. That's not biblical. And I'm not saying we tolerate or we condone anything sinful. When a person wants to become a Christian, you know, our job is to be teachers. Our job is to teach them what God wants them to do and help them understand what God's words allow and what it doesn't allow. And sooner or later, Jesus comes to them, just like he does to us, and he asks them to define their relationship. But we cannot expect unchurched people to act like a Christian before they're really a Christian.
That's right.
And they can't become a Christian unless we make them comfortable in God's house.
That's right.
The Apostle Paul says in Romans 10:14, how can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without somebody preaching to them?
Amen.
You have a great opportunity next week to bring in your unchurched friends. It's a barbecue. It's hard to invite people to church. Understand that. It's easy.